Good morning.
Good morning,
Pastor. I'd like to welcome you to Zwingli United Church of Christ on this beautiful day. Glad that you are here, whether you're attending in person or attending online through Facebook Live. Glad that all of you are here and will participate as fully as you possibly can in the worship service today. I invite those who are here to fill out the welcome sheets at the end of your rows and pass those along to your neighbor. And I invite the ones on Facebook live streaming to register or make sure you put your name in the chat so that we know that you are here with us. And we look forward to a meaningful service today and a time in which we can learn more about our faith and also welcome the presence of God's Spirit with us. So I have a few prayer requests to share with you today, and quite a few to share with you this morning. The first prayer is for Carmen Green. She was a nurse for my mother when she was in a nursing home back in December through April of this year. And just this wonderful woman who now has congestive heart failure and had to resign her position as a nurse. And so just prayers for Carmen as she goes through that, and also prayers for just thanksgiving for the many people she touched. Also, I ask continued prayers for my father, who's in nursing care now, going through kind of a difficult patch with his health. And so they're trying to get some things regulated, so prayers for him. Sally and I will be traveling down on Thursday through Sunday to continue work on the apartment and other matters that need to be taken care of. And so we ask for your traveling mercies and your prayers as we go down to Virginia once again. Also prayers this day for Kyle Sakamoto, who's dealing with illness, prayers that he may heal and heal quickly. We also ask prayers this day for Bill Walk, as you know, on hospice care, and he continues to decline. And so prayers not only for Bill and this aspect or part of his journey, but also for Esther, for Sue, and for the rest of the family. Prayers for Eileen's brother, Norman. Eileen, her brother, Norman Riley, died of colon cancer. He was only 65 years old. Eileen is a member of the Celtic Heirs and of Quadus, and so someone who's been here and a part of our congregation offering music and her talents, and so prayers for her and her family and the loss of her brother. Also prayers this day for Jim Bush's mother, Walda. She will be having heart valve surgery soon, be going through tests and other things before that happens, but prayers for her as she goes through those tests and as she prepares for surgery. And also prayers this day for Michael Kraft and his family on the loss of his brother Jim, who was in Iowa. I believe Michael and his sons went out for the memorial service, and so prayers for Michael and for the family. And then also we know another hurricane hit, so prayers for the victims of Hurricane Nicole on top of the hurricane that was through once before, and knowing some communities were hit twice. And so just prayers for them as they continue to struggle with what all that means. Well, those are all the prayer requests this morning. Again, if you have any, we ask you to please send those in to us during the week, either to Pastor Allen, myself, or to the office. So let us now, as we gather today, open our hearts, our minds, and our souls, that we can drink in the Spirit of God as we are here in this place. For those who are able, please stand for the call to worship. Come, all of you who live in the shelter of God's love.
We call upon God's name.
Come, all of you who seek refuge from the storms of this world.
We ask for God's protection.
Come, all of you who trust in God's steadfast faithfulness.
We seek the promises of God.
Come, worship and pray. that God may renew our strength. Gracious God, bless us this day that we might be faithful witnesses to the life and the suffering of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Redeemer. In our songs and our prayers and in our scriptures, spoken words and hymns, reveal to us the purpose for which we have been called by your Holy Spirit. As we worship, equip us for ministry with the faith and assurance only you can provide. Amen. Will you remain standing with me and join me in the prayer of confession? In humility, O Lord, we bow before you this morning to acknowledge our sinfulness. We ask forgiveness for words spoken in cruelty, for behavior that tears down rather than building up, for failures to take responsibility for our relationships with others and with you, for preferring temporal wealth over being rich in spirit. Forgive us, we pray, and lead us into fullness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. With thanksgiving, we draw waters of forgiveness and grace from the well of our salvation.
Christ promises that the faithful will not perish. Indeed, through our endurance, we gain our souls. Rejoice in the good news. We have been forgiven. Amen.
We gather here as followers of Christ. We gather here in the peace and grace of Christ. And so I say to you, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Okay, you know I said be not afraid. Are there times in that you've been afraid? Yeah? Anybody afraid of the dark? Thunderstorms? Earthquakes? I'm afraid of an earthquake. I don't want an earthquake around. You know, our lesson today from the Gospel in Luke tells us that Jesus was worried for his disciples because he told them that they were going to experience some very difficult times. They were going to be persecuted and that there was going to be war, earthquakes, anger, and all sorts of things that they had to deal with. And that people like us have to deal with. But he said, be not afraid, because I am always with you. And so I want you to remember that as you continue to sometimes be afraid, but know that Jesus is always with you. Right? There's one of the songs we used to sing, and we haven't sung it much lately, but it's called Be Not Afraid, and it goes like this. Be not afraid, I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you peace. Isn't that a wonderful message? Take that with you. Don't be afraid. Amen.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the 21st chapter of Luke, beginning in the 5th verse. Hear these words. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he, and the time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and in various places famines and plagues. and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and siblings, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. May God add a blessing to the hearing and the reading of these words this morning.
Thank you, choir and Steve. That was a beautiful piece and beautiful words that go really well with the scripture today and is one of the sermons that you have heard. So hopefully you will have heard that sermon. It'll probably be better than the next one you hear, but that sermon was just really wonderful. So if you didn't hear the words, I invite you to go back to Songbook 148 and look through that. I also want to thank Lori for giving the children's message this morning. Pastor Allen has been struggling with an infection that's getting better, and his voice is kind of froggy at times, and so she is helping out this morning, and also we're praying for Allen to heal as quickly as possible. The next scripture lesson is from Revelation chapter 3, beginning with the 14th verse. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, The words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the origin of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing. You do not realize that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. Therefore, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white robes to clothe you and keep the shame of your nakedness from being seen, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. I reprove the discipline those whom I love. Be earnest, therefore, and repent. Listen, I am standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come to you and eat with you, and you with me. To the one who conquers, I will give a place with me on my throne, just as I myself conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. May God add a blessing to the hearing and reading of God's holy word. Okay, so we haven't lost anyone yet. You must not have really been listening to the scripture today, because I can tell you, after hearing the gospel lesson and the passage from Revelation, I would imagine sometimes you might feel like, geez, I think I might just walk out today. These are a little tough on the ears to hear if you really listen to what is being said, and I wish I could completely unpack both scripture, because they're just filled with all kinds of imagery and wonderful things to talk about. But they do speak of judgment and a call to repentance. They speak of tumultuous times and the need for us to hold to the values and message of the gospel. And as difficult as they are to hear, there's a call for us to be good stewards of the gifts and graces that God has given to us. And so as we dig a little into the scripture passages, I have a painting to show you. And it should be up. Okay. There we go. The painting that most of you have seen before, right? So when you see this painting, what does it invoke in you? What do you feel? What does it make you think about? Yes?
Let me in.
Let me in. Open the door and let me in. What else? Jesus comes to us, absolutely. Yes?
I stand at the door and knock.
I stand at the door and knock. Anyone else? Yes, Rich.
Am I welcome?
Am I welcome? Wow, I like that one. Yes. We're going to keep that image up throughout the sermon, and you can look at that as much as you would like to. I think it's a really interesting painting. It's a painting by Werner Salmon called Christ at Heart's Door. And it's based on the Revelation passage that we just read. And it depicts, I think, in some ways, a gentle and peaceful Jesus in contrast to the harsh words spoken by Jesus in today's gospel. But it depicts, as many of you said, Jesus standing at the door. Standing at the door of what? Our hearts, standing at the door of our lives, standing at the door and knocking, wanting to be let in. The passage today, though, in Revelation, takes us a little bit in a different direction. Because when I see this picture, when I think about it, and when I've heard other people describe it, they see it as kind of an individual thing. Christ knocking on the door of our hearts, wanting to be let in. And I think that that's very, very true, that it is an image. It does give a metaphor of Jesus knocking constantly on our heart's door so that we will allow the Spirit of Christ into our lives. But as we read the scripture today, it isn't about individuals. It is actually about a community. Though Jesus wants to change individual lives and individual hearts, he is just as concerned, if not more concerned, about how we live our life as a faith community, as Wingly United Church of Christ, as the churches in the Pennsylvania Southeast Conference that will be meeting this afternoon, as the Church Universal. Jesus is concerned about how we live out Christ's message and spirit. Christ is concerned as to whether the church will actually let Jesus in, as if the church might sometimes keep Jesus out of the conversation. If you listen to the words of the passage, I love the one place where it says, "I reprove and discipline those whom I love. Be earnest, therefore, and repent." It's calling on all of us to repent. "Listen, I am standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice, open the door. I will come into you and eat with you, and you with me." These are not words to individuals, but to the church at Laodicea. And in that image, there's also an image of sharing the Lord's Supper together, of Jesus coming to commune with them. If they open the door of their hearts, and if they open the door to the life of themselves as a community, if they just open the door to the Spirit of Christ, Christ says, "I will come in." These words are given to a church at Laodicea because they have been poor stewards of God's message and gospel values. In Revelation, there are seven letters to seven churches, and one of the letters is to the church at Laodicea, and they have been poor stewards of God's message and God's gospel values. They have brought into their own lives empire values, the empire being Rome, and the empire values of wealth and worldly power. And the message that is in that particular passage today, it says things about, you know, you've relied on your wealth and on the things that you have achieved. These are the things that are taking you actually away from God and away from the way of Christ. They have also, we've learned from study, ignored the plight of those who are marginalized. And they began to idolize far too many things in the society associated with power and prestige and the empire at hand. It's a warning to the church in Laodicea, and a warning to the church today, and a warning to Zwingli United Church of Christ to get our priorities straight, to be sure that Jesus is at the center of our lives and at the center of our community of faith. That when we make decisions, when we talk about things, when we come to worship, when we meet in meetings, when we make decisions about what we might do in the world, when we make decisions about what we might do in this church, everything needs to be centered around Christ and Christ's values. It's especially true as we bear witness in the world. When the world or political leaders lead us into division, we are to bear witness to the unifying love of Jesus. We all know how much that has been needed over the last 4, 5, 6, even more years. When the world would have us turn our backs on the most vulnerable, as many people do, we're called to radical hospitality and to offer what we can to those in need. When our society continues to allow systemic racism and other forms of discrimination to exist day by day, we're called by Christ's vision and hope for the walls of separation to be torn down. Not just to be dismantled a little bit at a time, but to be torn down. And for us to repent. When the world does all it can to lead us away from the ways of God and Christ's community, the message of the gospel, the message of revelation, is that we are to put Christ first, to listen for Christ's voice, and to become a people who deepen our faith not only individually, but also as a community, so that we can share God's abundant grace. Now, in the passage from the gospel today, we get a very similar lesson. Jesus tells us, as we heard in the children's message, that the days are coming, and some pretty bad, frightening days, when we will be called to account and called upon to testify. He tells them not to rehearse, for God will put the words in their heart and in their mouth. He goes on to give other warnings and paint a picture of what seems like the last days, and that later the Son of Man, meaning him, will come again in clouds of glory. Now, when I was growing up, this passage, I was told, was about the end times and the second coming of Christ, and a warning of the Christian to the Christians of what was to come. But I have to admit, it's easy to get lost in all the drama and all the imagery and all the harsh words of Jesus. It's easy to get lost and to not really hear what Jesus is saying underneath. Well, the Reverend Yvette Schock says that Jesus' answer to his listeners' questions at the very beginning of the passage is not something that's really simple. We might read it as a simple thing, a simple playbook that Jesus is giving them, but it's not a checklist or a roadmap to help them navigate the days to come. It gives license neither for blind optimism nor for doomsday preparations, but it does contain a promise. The faithful will be called to witness, and when they are, God will be present and at work. In the midst of every kind of trouble, in the midst of everything that might be happening in their lives, they will be called to witness because they will see what God is building even then, in the midst of their troubles, in the midst of all that's going on. For those who walk in Christ's way, they will see or come to see what God is doing in the world. I like this angle that she takes because it is a message that we really need to hear, especially today. We just got through another election cycle, and man, oh man, is it just really depressing. It's depressing to just hear how people snipe at each other, how people always try to tear down rather than to build up. We hear in the midst of all of that and in so many other things, just all of this division and all of this rancor and people not really being able to understand how to get it together so that we can get together. But in the midst of this, in the midst of days like these, a picture is painted in which even though there might be difficult times, even though there might be division, even though there might be tribulations, we know that Christ is there in the midst of it, knocking on the door, asking to be let in, so that Christ's Spirit can find its way into all of those places. We'll hear about wars and rumors of wars. We'll hear that the world and all of its beauty can still be a really scary place. It's yet another time in history when things seem to be going off the rails at times, and we may feel as if our faith is being trampled or discounted. Others even come in Christ's name, but they display values that seem contrary to the ways of Christ. So we are called, in the midst of all that, to bear witness to a gospel of love, a gospel of inclusion, a gospel that seeks to lift up and not tear down. We also know that in the midst of this, we not only have communal kinds of things that are happening, but we also have personal trials and tribulations that are felt deeply in our hearts and souls, dealing with loved ones with addictions, facing struggles in relationships, being there when our children or parents suffer trauma, or being at the bedside of a loved one who is sick and dying. We too feel the weight of life and the struggles that exist sometimes daily. But our gospel lesson and Revelation passage offers encouragement that what is happening now is not what will be. The lesson today and the message of Jesus throughout his life is that the actions of God are of a God that is building up, that is saving, of a God that is working to make all things new. We are living in those times religious folk like to name the already and not yet. That we know that the kingdom of God and God's reign has come in Jesus, yet we also know that the kingdom is yet to come. that there will be struggles ahead. There will be things that we need to band together to make sure that we have a deep enough faith to deal with all of the things that confront us as people, as persons, and as a church. So what we are to do is to be ready to give voice to our faith and to what God has created, even when we can't always see clearly what that might be. What we are to do is to give testimony to one another, to stand together, to face the storms and the trials when they arise, and be grateful for those glimmers of the kingdom that break through now and again. What we are to do is to tell the truth from our hearts of what God is doing in our lives. Not just as we approach what some people might call the end times, or when things are at their worst, but to bear that truth, to bear that message day by day. Thinking maybe we should have a Sunday or two devoted to testimony. That would be something different for us, right? A Sunday or two, or three, or maybe more, where we offer our testimony and share from the depths of our hearts our struggles and how God has worked and is working in our lives. I would love this morning to bear witness to all the ways I've seen folks stand up and give witness to God at work. From the members who have been dismayed and horror-struck by what is going on in our country and still struggle to be open, still struggle to be caring, still struggle to be loving, still struggle to make sure that we try to talk to one another, even when they face words of hate. When they do this, when they bear witness in this way, they are bearing witness to a loving God. They are bearing witness to what God is doing right now in this world. They give testimony to the presence of Christ in our midst. Or maybe when you've been ignored or disrespected at work, and you still get up the next day and offer a smile, are diligent at your task, or even make the effort to improve the environment for others, you are bearing witness, giving testimony that God is present and at work. When folk who are already busy with so many things going on or dealing with their own struggles step up to serve at church or in a ministry, or if they step up to serve by visiting with others, or they step up to serve by giving in whatever small or large way they can, they are bearing witness. They are bearing witness to a God who is always with us, and in the midst of whatever we might be dealing with, can help us to be a part of a community of faith that bears witness to God's amazing grace. When a church tries to bear witness to extravagant hospitality, as I feel like we are trying to do, in a world where division and hatred seem to have the upper hand, we are bearing witness to a God who is working to create a new heaven and a new earth. Jesus stands at the door and knocks. Knocks at the door of our hearts. Knocks at the door of our community of faith, our church. Jesus comes and continually knocks, hoping to be let in. May we open our hearts, our lives, so that the Spirit of Jesus might live in us and through us each day. May it be so. Amen.
Thank you.
You, O God, are supreme and holy. You create our world and give us life. Your purpose overarches everything we do. You have always been with us. You are God. You, O God, are infinitely generous, good beyond all measure. You came to us before we came to you. You have revealed and proved your love for us in Jesus Christ, who lived and died and rose again. You are with us now. You are God. You, O God, are Holy Spirit. You empower us to be your gospel in the world. You reconcile and heal. You overcome death. You are our God. We worship you. You may be seated. Let us join together in prayer. Holy One, thank you for this day to be reminded about being a community together, about living out your word more fully, to hear you knocking at our door, and to be a people of welcome and radical inclusion and hospitality. To embrace our community that's around us. And so this morning we come to you with concerns on our hearts and minds this morning. We lift up to you Butch's dad as he continues on in his living situation and the medical care that he's receiving. We pray that you would ease that for him, that you would be with Butch and Sally as they travel down this week to take care of things, to get things situated for his dad, to take care of the apartment, all of the things that go into his dad's transition to this new living arrangement. Give them wisdom in all that they do. Give them strength to endure, and peace that passes all understanding. We think of Carmen, one of Butch's mother's nurses, who we learned has congestive heart failure and had to resign. We pray for her as she transitions into this new way of living and being, and we just pray that you would help her to settle into that, to be at peace with it, and to find new ways of caring and to being who she is with the limitations she has now. We think of Kyle, who's dealing with illness. We just pray that you would heal his body. Selfishly, I ask for myself that you would heal me, restore my voice fully, and clear up this infection. We pray for Bill Walk. It's good to visit with him this week, but we just pray that he would have comfort and peace, and that the family would have peace, and for all those who are with him during this journey. And we think too of Eileen, whose brother passed away this week. We just pray for comfort and peace there as well. We think of Jim's mom, Walda, as she prepares to have heart surgery. We just pray that you would give the doctors wisdom, guide their hands, and help her to have a quick recovery. We think of Michael, who's visiting his brother this week, or visiting the family to bury his brother this week. And we just pray that this would be a meaningful time of being together with family, strengthening bonds that are there. And finally, God, we think of all those who were in the path of Nicole this week, for the storm surge, for the houses that are falling off the sandy dunes. We just pray that you would give everyone there wisdom, that you would help them to get back to living normally as quickly as possible. There's so many concerns, and we just lift them up to you. We place them in your hands, God. We ask for your will be done, and we ask it in the name of Jesus, who taught us together to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We come now to the time of our stewardship moment, and so I'm going to invite Joanne Kramlich up to speak to us about that this morning.
Our theme this year for the stewardship campaign is From Bread and Cup to Faith and Giving. And the biblical passage that was chosen today is from the Revelations 3, 14 to 22. Jesus knocks at the door and comes in to eat. So thank you, Butch, for the wonderful sermon, because I didn't really have to do my message here. So anyway, what I was going to say is, you all have seen that painting. It's from Warner Salmon, Christ at the Heart's Door. This work creates an intimate feeling by picturing Christ in a long, luminous robe, a gentle look on his face, his hand raised to the wooden door and gently knocking. When I look at the picture, because it's one of my favorites, I've always just looked at it as Jesus knocks at the door to come in to have a cup of coffee, a soda, relax, and socialize. But after reading the message, it really did touch me that the picture really does evoke a sense of Christ wanting to enter a believer's heart in a very tender way. The image, it feels like a reminder to pay attention, the image of him knocking at the door. It is hard to ignore someone at your door, right? Somebody comes knocking, you can't really ignore it too well. So in what areas of your life is Jesus knocking the loudest? Is it to give your time to a particular need in the community or church? Is Jesus saying, you know you have a talent for organizing, for cleaning, cooking, teaching, caring, and here are people that need that gift? Or maybe it is about how to share your tithe to a ministry strong, to make the ministry stronger. And that in that way you can think about your own givings and if you can increase it or how you want to proceed with that. If you haven't heard the knocking yet, I encourage you to take time to listen. Christ surely wants to be in the heart of the believer. The heart is not just a place associated with emotion, but it is the center of the self. We might think of it as the operation center, where thoughts and feelings come together to shape our values and practices for life. Lord, we hear you knocking on the doors of this church too. May this time of worship be an opening of our hearts, of our community to you. We desire deeply to be with you and for you to be with us. I encourage you to listen for Jesus' knock and be ready to open that door. As a stewardship, simply put, it is what we do with what we have. Thank you.
Thank you.
us go to God in prayer. We thank you, God, for being our strength and shield, our salvation and our hope. As we have drawn joy from the springs of your salvation, may our gifts become springs of hope to a world thirsty with need. Empower our lives and our gifts that we may become instruments of your healing and peace. In the name of our Creator God, we pray. Amen. So for the announcements, I ask you to please pay attention to the announcements that are in the bulletin, of which there are many, and there are going to be others that will come as we get closer to the Advent season. I have two announcements that are not in the bulletin. One is, I hope that you paid attention to at least one of the four sermons today. There is one by the choir, there's one that I gave, there is one in the song after the message, and thank you, Joanne, for the message you gave. I really appreciate that. And so hopefully you paid attention at one time during the service to hear just some incredible ways of looking at our faith and how we can live that out. The other announcement I have is about an Advent book study that will be led by Pastor Allen. And it's about the heart that grew three sizes. And it's, I can't read my writing. Oh my gosh. Examining the Christian message through the story of the Grinch, as you can imagine. So it's going to be on Wednesday evenings at 7 o'clock, starting on November 30th. And going for what, 4 weeks? Going for 4 weeks. If you would like to be a part of that, please email Pastor Allen. Or I'm sure if you emailed the church that Lisa would get the message to Pastor Allen as well.
In person or Zoom?
It's both in person and Zoom. So it'll be a hybrid gathering. I think that's what you did last time. So it'll be a hybrid gathering like the last time. So if you're interested in that, it sounds like a really fascinating study. Hope that you'll be a part of it. So those are all the announcements I'll share this day. Let us now stand and sing, I Walk the King's Highway.